We have been preaching through this great book, and we are making a stride toward the finish line. Almost done. Ephesians chapter 6, not that we're trying to get done. This has been a great practical book. The beginning of Ephesians is great theology. The end is very great practicology. If that's not a word, I just invented it. Good stuff. Monday morning kind of living stuff. I'd like to preach to you a message entitled, Wrestling with the Devil. You say, Pastor, I do that every week. I could preach that sermon. How many of you feel like you wrestle with the devil? Say amen. Well, you do. And I don't say that in any strange way or any funny way by any means. There should be a certain fear in the right way, an understanding. And I hope tonight we will seriously look at these things. Let's begin before we read our text and ask the Lord one more time to clear our minds and to give His presence. Father, we know Your presence is here. You promised that, Lord. We are gathered. We are the temples of the Holy Ghost. Lord, You are all around in this place. As we saw this morning, the invisible God stands with us. And Lord, I pray that we would yield ourselves and bend ourselves to hear what You have to say. Lord, I need You. I pray that You would touch these lips. I ask, Father, that You would work in my heart first. I thank You so much for deliverance and for power, and that You are stronger in every way than the devil. In Jesus' name, amen. In preaching through Ephesians, we have come to some very applicable verses in this last chapter 5 and chapter 6. We saw a lot of things about the home. If you weren't here and you did not hear those messages on the home, on the husband, on the wife, on the children, I would encourage you greatly to get those messages. If you know somebody who's having marital problems or family problems, I would highly encourage you to direct them to the website where they can hear and see those messages, streaming those sermons on the sermon page of the website. It's not the sermons that are of any value. It's the Word of God that is of great value. And really, that's probably the only thing that will save their home. We've come now, after these many relationships, in chapter 6 to see a very serious thing. We plunge into a very familiar section of verses, beginning of verse number 10. But I want to warn you to fight something tonight. To fight against allowing familiarity to breed contempt of thinking that you already have been here, you've heard this. Many of us have these verses memorized, and so there's always the chance that they don't mean as deeply as if you heard them the first time. You understand what I mean, right? So act like you've never seen this before. Act like God is telling you something tonight that is fresh and that is new and something that you've never seen. It's something that you need and that I need. In Ephesians 6, beginning of verse number 10, if you would stand, I'd like to read you these 8 or 9 verses. And kind of wrapping up the last points of the whole book, he says, God says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, that is, against things that are physical, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, or in the day that the devil attacks you, or his minions attack you. And having done all by putting on this armor to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. There's no way in the world that I could get through all this tonight. We are only going to talk about the first piece of armor, truth. You may be seated. The opening command here is to be strong. It's a very positive thing. Be strong. It's very positive. But it is covering up a negative thing about you and about me. It says be strong. Notice, it doesn't end there. It says be strong in the Lord. And then it doesn't end there at all. It says, and it's like if you missed it, let me tell you that again. And in the power of His might. That is a positive command that covers up something negative about you and about me. It's positive in the power of God. There he is, the powerful one. In fact, there is no one stronger than him. Dave Mincy, who we had as a concert, he sings a song. He wrote the song, "You Are God, There Is No One Else Like You." God is uniquely the powerful one. There, it's not like Star Wars. There is not a dark side and a light side, and they are equal in any way. There is only one side. It's God's side. And he is the most powerful thing going. He is the only God. The devil is his creation, a fallen angel that doesn't have a piddlance of his power. So don't you fear that. There's no problem with God. Amen. He is all powerful. There's no one stronger than him. He has infinite power, and he makes that power, and this is the great part, available to you and I to fight the devil. But we must understand that it is his power and not our power, that it is his might. In all ways, your God is stronger than the devil. However, the thing that is negative here and is very revealing about us, that the power to fight our foes, our main foes in our Christian life, which is the world, the flesh, and the devil, specifically tonight, does not come from us. Let me say this another way. You don't have any power. We told a lady yesterday on soul winning, I don't even trust myself. You know, we don't have any power in and of ourselves. We are no match for the devil. You know, there's old stories about preachers who'd pick up inkwells and throw them at the devil. That's scary business, all right? We have no fight against the devil. Our power and our might must come from the Lord. It's very revealing about ourselves. The command here reveals that we need power outside of ourselves. There's nobody with the character here to fight the devil. There's nobody with the integrity. There's nobody here with the honesty. There is nobody here with the spiritual strength. So just forget it, buddy. I don't care how long you've been saved and how many times you've been a deacon or whatever. There's no one here, including your pastor, that is strong enough in his strength to fight the devil. And that's probably why we fail most of the time, because we got that idea wrong. It's in the Lord and the power of his might. Yet when we have struggles in our lives, we naturally try to fight in our human strength. We try to fight with what we have in our power. We're trying to fight spiritual forces. The devil is a spiritual being. His minions are spiritual with our human resources and our human strength. You got a stump in your yard, guys, you can get a piece of iron underneath of that, and maybe with enough strength, or chain it to your 4x4, you can rip it out of there with your strength and your power. That's not how the devil works. But yet there's so many of us that try to fight him with our sweat, our determination, our hard work, our determination that I am not going to give in to him this time. Well, how are you going to fight him? I'm just determined. That will fail every time. Right. Our hard work, our character is not strong enough. Our body is not strong enough. When we are in temptation or trial or negative circumstances that we don't understand, we try to reach down inside of ourselves and be strong to endure it or to overcome it. The problem is you're just fooling yourself. We're just fooling ourselves. And that kind of going over and over and over to our own strength brings only failure. We will fail that way. We don't have any inner strength, especially to fight spiritual battles. In verse number 11, and I bring your attention back to it, verse 10 and 11, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. It was never intended in this verse for you to think that you are going to take on the devil. It has to be his power. And we need to learn what his power is and how to use his power. You may say, well, when I have spiritual battles, when I have difficulties in my life, or I have the devil is attacking me, I don't do that. I immediately pray about my struggles of life and my attacks. That sounds great, doesn't it? Christian, that's good, but I want to point out to you as you scan the page, look down at your Bibles in verse number 10 through verse number 17 or whatever. I want to point out to you that praying is not mentioned until six other weapons against the devil are. You understand what I'm saying? It is natural, and I'm not saying it's not good. It is good for you to pray. I just saw Rich Baker sitting right there. How are you, brother? I'm glad you're here. You probably need this message. And I do too. Amen. It's natural for us to think that we're doing the spiritual thing and immediately go to prayer. That is great, okay? It's right to pray. It's right to appeal to God. But I want to tell you, he told you six other things to do before that. Six